Welcome everyone, thanks for coming despite the nice weather. I'm very happy to introduce Professor Panos Ipeirotis from NYU Stern. Panos got his PhD from Columbia. He won too many best paper awards, so I will not enumerate all of them, right? Graduating from Columbia, he moved to the dark side, to the business school, right? But he, I guess he's still a computer scientist in his heart. And he's been working quite a bit on crowdsourcing. So he's one of the worldwide experts on crowdsourcing, Mechanical Turk, and all kinds of, you know, issues related to crowdsourcing. And today he's going to talk about Quizz, targeted crowdsourcing with 1 billion potential users. And it seems that it's some work he did while at Google. So Panos, the floor is yours. Thanks
Thank you very much for having me here. So, okay, so is the mic okay? Okay, good. Okay, so what I'm going to talk today is about some work that I have done a while on sabbatical at Google. So I arrived at Google to start my sabbatical, and they tell me the following things. So we want to do crowdsourcing. And what does this mean? We have a lot of people that come to our website. We have 1 billion people that use Google. All these people know a lot of things that we don't know. And we want to use their knowledge to improve our products. This is the type of crowdsourcing that we want to do. And to put things a little bit in context, over the last 3 or 4 years at Google, there was a massive change, infrastructural change at Google, which they call it things, not strings. What does this mean? Means that within Google, instead of representing things as words and keywords and so on, now everything is an entity. For example, when you have the word Kyrgyzstan, it's not just a word. It is, Google knows that this is a country, which means that it has attributes like a capital, currency, a president, and so on. And capital of Kyrgyzstan is Bishkek, which is a city, which is another entity, and so on. So pretty much everything that is being indexed at Google gets resolved into one of these entities. So, and why this thing is useful, because as we move to mobile interaction, for example, you are on your phone, instead of typing something, you typically speak to your phone, and the mode of interaction is very different. You don't scan the results to find the page that you want, and then you read the page to find the information. Instead, you might want to ask things like, what's the capital of South Africa? You ask your phone, for example, and Google, instead of giving you back a list of results now, what it does, it tells you, you know, South Africa capitals. Well, South Africa has apparently 3 capitals, Pretoria, Cape Town, and Bloemfontein. And if you are on your phone, it will actually speak back to you the answer. This thing is called the knowledge graph at Google. It contains approximately 500 million entities and 5 to 6 links that connect these 5 or 6 billion links that connect these entities. And despite the size, though, the knowledge graph is still highly incomplete. So for example, if you go to Google and ask for the date of birth of Bayes, well, Google doesn't know that. It's still uncertain. So if you ask what's the symptom of strep throat, Google doesn't know that. If you see what is the side effect of Trexamet, which is a drug used to treat strep throat, Google doesn't know that. If you ask who is Cristiano Ronaldo dating, Google doesn't know that. When is Jay-Z playing in New York, Google doesn't know that. And what's the customer phone number for Google, Google doesn't know that. So there are a lot of things that Google doesn't have in the knowledge base. So, however, if you look at these things, excluding the first one, which is inherently uncertain, many users of Google know the answers for these questions. So, for example, someone might know where, you know, by reading the latest gossip, who is Cristiano Ronaldo dating right now, or when Jay-Z is playing in New York, or, you know, even what are the symptoms of strep throat and so on. So the mission was given us, okay, we have these billion users that come to our website, they ask questions, can we get them to contribute back to the knowledge graph and give us all the information they have in order to improve the coverage and the knowledge that we have. And the typical enthusiastic idea is, okay, let's build a new crowdsourcing system to do that, which most of the time when someone tells me something like that, I bite my tongue. And because most of the people, when you talk about crowdsourcing, they know only the successes. So for example, Google say, well, let's build something like Wikipedia. We'll build a site, people will come and write very detailed articles about all the entities, describing them, and so on. Or we'll build something, the ESP game. For those of you that might not have heard about that, it's a game where two random people get matched to play together. The only thing that they see is a common image, and the way that they can get points and win is to type the same word. So you look at an image, you are matched with a random player, and you need to type the same word as the other player. And typically, if you type the same word, this word represents something that exists in that image. That's the ESP game. Or reCAPTCHA, with the basic idea is that you are trying to prove that you are a human. You are given two words that are scrambled. You need to type these words. The key idea is that Google knows only one of these two words. The other one came from a digitized book. The optical character recognition didn't work very well, so Google doesn't know how that, for example, this one might be the word upon. However, if you type the other one correctly, then we can get, we trust that if you type the known one correctly, the unknown one is correct as well. These are the successes of crowdsourcing. And most of the people look at this and they say, oh, you know, crowdsourcing, nice, easy, free. So in reality, though, building crowdsourcing systems is, the space is more littered with the dead bodies of that. So for example, just three examples from Google. Google trying to build its own Wikipedia built null, in which they were saying we'll get experts to write the descriptions for the entities as opposed to random people. They bought the licensed ESP game from Carnegie Mellon, and they built Google Image Glaber, exactly the same idea. And for social search, people could ask other people for answers. They had Aardvark. The answer is that all three of them were shut down a few years back because none of them worked. None of them could motivate people to contribute. And the striking example is Google Image Labeler, which was tremendously successful at CMU. And the same idea was applied within Google and failed spectacularly because, you know, a variety of reasons, actually. So from design to, you know, to many other things. So now, what's the common solution? So the crowdsourcing projects fail because you cannot motivate people. So what's the common solution? Well, introduce a very clear, unambiguous incentive. You pay people. So you go to Mechanical Turk, you post tasks there, you pay people. People come and complete the tasks because they get paid a few cents for each task that they do there. Same thing with Crowdflower, or you can even go to Odesk and hire a few people to do the work that you need, from annotation to, you know, to translation to programming or whatever else you want. Now, the problem with that is that when you pay people, you have the advantage of having predictability in terms of engagement, but you have the following problems. First of all, you need to pay them. Well, obvious monetary cost. Second, and quite often more important, when you pay people, people have the incentive to misrepresent their qualifications in order to get paid. For example, you want to hire people to annotate medical documents. Do you know anything about medicine? Sure, sure. I had experience. I was a secretary of a doctor booking the appointments at some point, but you know, I have experience. I was working in the health industry for 20 years. So there is also a additional research in psychology that says that when you pay people, even if these people are intrinsically motivated to do something, you, in quotes, crowd out the intrinsic motivation, because at that point you have quantified how much you value their contributions. So as a classic example from Dan Ariely is that you go to your mother-in-law, they have you for dinner, and at the end of the dinner you say, okay, you know, that was really nice. Here is 50 francs for your effort, you know, instead of saying just thank you, you know. So the second, once you involve money, things get complicated. And the most important is, quite often in labor markets, you don't have access to people that have the knowledge that you need, right? For example, if I want to do medical crowdsourcing, Mechanical Turk might not have people with medical knowledge. If I want to do specific translation from, let's say, Persian or Farsi into English, I might not have access to, you know, Persian people on Mechanical Turk and so on. So volunteers typically are better, but it's much harder to predict success. So just to summarize after the long introduction, and here was the mission statement. What we want to do is we want to crowdsource, but we want this thing to happen in a very predictable manner with users that are knowledgeable, and we don't want to introduce any monetary rewards. That was the goal. So how did you achieve that? Okay. Here's the basic idea. We built a small app, which is accessible actually in this website, Quizz, that looks like that. People arrive in this website and they play a small quiz. For example, here is a quiz about medical disease symptoms. What is a symptom of Morgellons? And the answers are red eye, chorioathetosis, skin lesion, insomnia, or I don't know. And the basic idea of this quiz is very reCAPTCHA-like. What happens is that for some questions we know the correct answer, for some others we don't. So what we do is we use these calibration questions, which are questions for which we know the answer, in order to estimate how well the particular user knows a topic. Then we give them the so-called collection answers, collection questions for which we don't know the answer. And of course, as we collect the answers, we trust more the answers that come from competent users. So in terms of technical trade-offs, the basic idea is, well, how can I balance the two, right? So I can ask a lot of questions that I know the answer, and I can estimate very well the quality of the user. But in that case, I don't get any work done. Or I can try to get work done and ask a lot of collection questions. But in that case, I don't really know the quality of the users that participate. So I will talk more about that. But the basic idea is that we built a Markov decision process, very simple one, which is the following. Let's say that I have a user that we asked them so far A plus B calibration questions. They gave A correct answers, B incorrect answers. We also asked them C collection questions. We have a value from this user, which is equal to the C collection answers that they answered, multiplied with the value that we get from the user that answered A correct and B incorrect questions. Now, once we have were in that mode, the user might continue, or with some probability, the user might drop out. We'll get back to that. So if the user continues, we have two choices. We can either give the user a question for which we know the answer and do an exploration of the user quality, and the user can give either a correct answer or an incorrect. In that case, the value of the user is changing and is equal, again, C, which is the number of questions that are collection questions, multiplied now with a new utility, which is A plus one correct answers and B incorrect, or vice versa here. Or we can decide to exploit the user and say we don't need to know more about the user, so we have the same utility, but now we asked one more collection question, so we increased our utility. So we'll get back to this definition. So now, that's the framework. Of course, someone looks at that and says, okay, nice idea, but you haven't answered any of the questions that you put at the beginning. So first of all, why would anyone come and play this game, right? Second, and more important, why would anyone knowledgeable would come and play this game? So I have a medical quiz. Why would any doctor come and spend time on that? See, isn't it just simpler instead of trying to do all these shenanigans to pay people and get over it? So how do we get people? We started thinking about how can we do targeting and get people to participate and so on. We started reading the literature, and we're running into advertising paper one after the other, how we can do targeting on the web. And we said, okay, why should we reinvent the wheel? We are sitting on top of one of the biggest targeting mechanisms in the world, the Google advertising system, so why not just reuse it? And what we did, actually, we reused it completely as a black box, no access to any internal algorithms, nothing. We just opened an account as a run-of-the-mill advertiser on Google, and we started running advertising campaigns, very, very simple campaigns like that. You go, and while you are browsing Google or you are in some website that displays ads from Google, you see an ad like that. Quiz on disease symptoms, test how well you can recognize various disease symptoms. You click on that, you arrive on our website, and you play the quiz. Now, a couple of things. So first of all, we want to get good users. We just don't want to get just clicks for people to show up on our website. We don't sell ads. We want people to do things. So we don't care just about visits. We care about visits from high-quality people that give good answers. Second, we don't really want to spend time optimizing the campaign itself, doing keyword selection, ad text optimization, and so on. Third, we really don't want to micromanage each of these campaigns. We want to set them up automatically and have a campaign for medical topics, another one for celebrity gossip, another one for sports, another one for local geography of Mongolia, and stuff like that. So how did we do that? The key idea is we present our website to the advertising system as an e-commerce site. E-commerce sites, they don't care if they get a large number of visitors. They care of getting a large number of people that buy stuff. So what we do is we say, okay, for every click, we measure the contributions of the user, and we give back feedback to the advertising system saying, well, that user came and left without doing anything. That was not a good click. Try not to give me people like that. Or this user came, answered 200 questions, 200 of them correct, 195 of them correct. That was really a good user. Send me more users like that. Or this user came, but answered a lot of questions, but the quality was not great. That was not really a great user. Don't send me users like that. So by doing that, you are effectively training the advertising system and customize it to send people that work well for your particular application. So just a technical digression now to see how we measure the value of a user. The basic concept that we use is the concept of information gain. What is information gain? Let's say that we have a question with four multiple choice answers. The uncertainty that we have in that case is 2 bits, is log of n, because we don't know what's the probability of each one of them being correct one. So the information gain is once the user gives us an answer, how many bits of information they contribute. And just intuitively, if a user is completely random and the probability q of giving a correct answer is 1 out of n, effectively random, then this person gives 0 information gain. On the other hand, if we have a user which is always perfect and gives always the correct answer, then this person gives maximum information gain, which is log of n. So for example, if we have question with four multiple choice answers. The uncertainty initially is 2 bits. This user is perfect and gives us the correct answer, so we get an information gain of log of n. And information gain has this nice characteristic that it is additive. So the total information gain is the number of questions given by the user multiplied by the information gain for the question. So the quality of the user, we can compute it using the number of correct and incorrect answers. So the simple definition would be quality is equal to the number of correct answers divided by the number of total answers. It gets a little bit more complicated because you have uncertainty. So if you have given 1 out of 1, it's not that you are perfect. We have uncertainty about your quality. So we do some Bayesian estimation, but I will skip the technicalities on that. Now, so the Markov decision process in that case gets transformed into that. So the value of a user is the number of collection questions that he answered multiplied by the estimated information gain per question, which is based on the number of correct and incorrect calibration questions that the user gave. And then the system decides on the fly whether to, it's better to ask a collection question or whether to ask a collection or a calibration question. So now, we started, we ran the system, and it started working really well. But at that point, people came and said, OK, I like this idea of targeting, but the question is your targeting useful? Yes, I can see that you get good results. But is this really the result of targeting, or is this the result that you throw 10,000 users on your website? And you know what? If you throw a large number of users, some of them, they are going to give answers. So for that, we ran an experiment for a month. We ran 2 versions of the website. In one of them, the control one, we ran a campaign, but we're not giving any feedback back to the advertising system. And we didn't do any real targeting. We didn't try to select keywords to target and so on. So in that case, the advertising system effectively was trying to send as many clicks as possible because we're not saying anything else. So Google, the only thing that they knew was that we ran a campaign, we pay for clicks, so it was trying to optimize for clicks. And we ran a treatment campaign in which we enabled feedback and we're giving feedback to Google whether the user participated or not and how much. So here are the results, fundamental. So first of all, both campaigns, they got the same number of users, approximately 4,000 users, if I remember correctly, 5,000 visitors. Now, conversion rate. What is a conversion? Conversion meant that the user participated in at least one question. The control had a 13% conversion rate, which means out 1 out of 7 users was actually answering at least one question. The treatment one had 34% conversion rate. And not only that, if we see the results over the month, they both started at approximately the same number, 13%. And over the month, as the system was optimizing itself, it ended up at the end of the month having a conversion rate of 50%. 1 out of the 2 users that were coming from the targeting was actually participating. So we get 3 times more participating users. In terms of how many answers we got from these users, the treatment campaign had 2,800 versus approximately 280, almost 10 times more answers. So even among the users who participated, the number of answers given were 3 times higher among the treatment group for a total performance gain of 10x. And if we look at the information gain, which also considers the quality of the answers given, we're getting 11 times more bits, which means that out of the users that were coming in the website, users participated more. Out of those that participated, they were giving 3 times more answers, those that participate. And out of all these answers, the quality of the submitted answers was higher among those that were coming from the treatment campaign, which actually was a strong indication of having, you know, an effective targeting mechanism. We also did an extra experiment where we're examining how much information gain contributes. And again, now the control case was we told you that the user participated, but we didn't tell you how much. And again, we have observed improvements. You know, we had 30% higher conversion rate when we're giving the conversion value. We have more answers, and we have even more correct answers coming back. So a very, you know, impressive result. Now, here's an example of the targeting. So when we started running the targeting campaign, we wanted also to have examples of topics that are not crowdsourceable. For example, we're thinking medical topics cannot be crowdsourced. Health topics require specialized knowledge. Doctors have other things to do. They are not going to play games on the internet. So we're thinking that health topics cannot be crowdsourced. But we realized, to our big surprise, that that was not the case. The medical topics were the best performing quizzes. We are talking about people coming and answering 200 questions in a row, 195 of them correct. And these were questions that we were reading them and we couldn't even understand what the question was asking. You know, what's a symptom of something that I couldn't read? And 4 answers that I couldn't understand the answer side. So we're looking at that and we're saying, who are these people? So we started looking at which websites they were coming from. And we realized that none of them was coming from websites that were targeting medical professionals. Most of them were coming from websites that were discussing consumer-oriented health topics, like Mayo Clinic, Healthline, you know, WebMD, and so on. So these people were effectively consumers. That's one of the hypotheses, that were really interested in the topic. They were reading a lot about medical topics. Maybe they cared deeply about that because they were personally affected. And when they started participating in the quiz, they could reaffirm the knowledge about the topic, and they were enjoying assessing themselves. Asterisk, someone said that instead of being these hypochondriacs of the internet that participate, there might be actually medical students, because based on the observation that in Wikipedia, most of the medical topics are written actually by medical students who contribute highly detailed information. So it's a valid hypothesis. Now, that was an example of targeting, but I want to dig deeper in here. So we also examined not where, what are the websites that people come from, but how much they participate. Perhaps not surprisingly, we have seen a very heavy-tailed distribution of participation. We have a large number of users that contribute a little bit, and we have a small number of heavy hitters that participate a lot. So here's the plot. Here's the number of users on the x-axis, and here is how much information they contributed. So what we have here is we have approximately 10 users that contribute about 1,000 bits each. This is approximately, you know, 2 bits per answer, 500 answers, and, you know, even more answers. So at this point, we have approximately 10,000 bits contributed by the total of these users. Here we have 100 users, each contributing about 100 bits. And again, here it's the equivalent point of having 10,000 bits by these users. And here we have 1,000 users that contributed each 10,000 bits. And we have here, you know, 10,000 users that each one contributed to one bit or something like that. Now, all these points are equivalent, but in this level, we are paying, let's say, 10 cents to get the user, and we get 1,000 hits. Here, we are paying 100 cents to get the users. Here, we are paying 10 times more. So in terms of cost benefit, we have an order of magnitude improvement for each heavy hitter. So each heavy hitter is worth 10 times a medium hitter, 100 times a low hitter, and 1,000 times more than the casual user that comes to a few questions at Quizz. So participation is really important. So initially, I thought that these are the really useful users, but really what you care about is this part. You really, really want to get people to participate as much as possible, which actually indicated that in our system, what we really care about is the probability of survival. So what we really want to do is not only assess the users, but we want the users to stay as much as possible, which actually led us to start measuring the effect of different retention mechanisms. So first of all, we want to see what's the effect of feedback. So the user participates. We had a control example where we let them complete the quiz, and at the end, we tell them how well they did. The first experiment that we did was telling them immediately after each answer whether they gave the correct answer or not. That actually worked, improved participation by about 2% in terms of information gain, which actually indicates that people like immediate feedback. But the next condition that we tried was not only telling them whether they were correct or incorrect, but also telling them what was the correct answer if they gave an incorrect one. That improved participation by 20%, which is really high, which also indicated that people don't come just to assess themselves, but they want to learn. So part of the experience is learning about the topic as they solve the quiz, and therefore they stick around to learn things. We also experimented with different scoring mechanisms, so showing them, for example, what's their percentage of being correct. One interesting one was when we started showing them as a score the number of correct answers that they gave, there is this internal targeting that happens. So people say, well, I really want to go to 10 correct answers. So at some point, they start giving effectively semi-random answers as guesses in order to reach their target numbers, so which actually meant that people give more questions but of lower quality. And when we show them information gain, actually we improved participation by approximately 4%. Now, one of the big wins was when we decided to show them the performance of other users in the same question. That actually improved participation by approximately 10%. Quick question, when is better, to show it before the question or after the question? That was another experiment. After. Why after? That's correct, actually. That is correct. What happens if you show the user before that the question is going to be very difficult? They drop. That's exactly correct. So it's always better to tell them afterwards. So what happens is that people drop out quite a lot if they give an incorrect answer. If they see that many other people failed, they stick around. So they say, ah, that was a hard one. But I continue. So if you tell it before, people drop out in anticipation of failure. So we said, OK, so given that competition works, let's introduce leaderboards. We introduced leaderboards, and initially, things started working really well. We're very happy with, you know, participation increased. As the experiment was going on, we started seeing participation, the effect of leaderboards going down. So it went effectively to zero. We said, okay, we're unlucky. Not unlucky, actually, we were lucky early on. So once the sample size became bigger, the effect went back to zero. We said, okay. But as the experiment ran, we started noticing a strongly negative effect. So instead of converging to zero, the effect of leaderboard started being strongly negative. So we're trying to figure out what is going on. And we realized that designing leaderboards is very, very tricky. So what people care about when they have a leaderboard is getting to the top 10. There is a tremendous competition among people that are just about to get to the top screen or to the top places. And actually, the competition to get to the top 10 is much higher compared to getting to the top 1 or top 2. A bad design choice that we made was that we were running an all-time leaderboard, which meant that the early users that came, they could easily get to the top 10. As time went by, the top score started becoming further and further and further away from the performance of a regular user, which meant that people were not being influenced and were not being attracted to get into the high scores. And at some point, it became so far away that people were arriving at the game, looking at their score, and they were saying, like, okay, I have 3 points, and the high score has 6,000 points. Okay, forget about it, I'm getting out. So for these users, it made sense not to see the leaderboard, and it started having a negative answer. So what's the solution? The solution is that we had to have a running window with exponential waiting on more recent scores to effectively encourage recent users to participate as opposed to letting people that participated 3 times ago to dominate the leaderboards. Okay, so we also did some further experiments, and it was published this year at TapTapTap, on what is the effect of, for example, difficult questions. So, and we started actively detecting whether a user is about to drop out. And if the user is about to drop out, we started giving them easy questions. You know, boost their scores, they participate more. The other thing that we tested was people have a bias to complete things. So if you have a quiz with 10 questions, nobody is going to drop out at the 9th question. So the question is, however, there is the other effect that once they complete, they drop out. So the question is, what was the right size of the quiz? Should I make it 3 question, 7 question, 10 question? What we realized was that you don't have a perfect one. Actually, infinite is best. But when you realize that the user is about to drop off by detecting timing and so on, say, okay, 3 more questions, and we're done. 3 is an achievable goal. When you realize that someone is about to drop off, you need to give them a very short-term goal in order to participate further. People work well when they have short-term goals. And there were a few other papers actually published in the last few years about that topic. Yes?
What happens after these questions are frozen?
They drop out. I mean, the well, we do tell them, you know, okay, now next level, or, you know, try to get another quiz, but there is a very big drop-off once you achieve your goal. So that one we didn't manage to carry over easily people to the next part. So, okay. So here is some cost-benefit analysis that we did, where we ran multiple topics, some health topics, disease symptoms, and so on, some music, artist, and album, and some film directors, movie actors. And here is the cost-benefit analysis, how much we had to spend to the advertising system to get enough users in order to get a 99% estimated accuracy for an answer. So on average, we had to pay 16 cents to achieve, for each answer, in order to achieve 99% accuracy. So, which was actually pretty significant reduction from Google was spending approximately 30 cents as a point of reference by paying people from contractors to do this verification. And however, one thing that I want to emphasize, so this is the average across all the quizzes that we experimented with. However, we had very big diversity. So for example, if you see disease symptoms, the average cost was 2 cents per question, which was fantastic. Or, you know, even the disease causes, you know, 7 cents was pretty good. You know, latest album, 9 cents. These are, but we have one which was a big outlier and we couldn't improve it. 54 cents cost for the quiz about matching an artist with a song, which was very puzzling because if you see the other two music quizzes, they had reasonable cost, pretty much in line with the other ones. So we're trying to figure out what is going on, and this thing doesn't work. And participation was pretty bad. So what was going on in this one was the following. We're asking people to match, to find the song for an artist and vice versa. However, we had absolutely no coherence across questions. So for example, one question might be about a country singer, next one about a heavy metal band, then about a K-pop singer, then about a Bollywood actor, and so on. No matter how much you try to target, there is simply not a single person that has such a breadth of knowledge to know individual songs for individual artists and to be able to do this matching out of his head. In contrast, the latest album, you can find people that are familiar with the music industry and they might have heard what is the latest album of Beyoncé. I don't know the songs of Beyoncé, but I have heard what is the latest album of Taylor Swift, of you know, different bands. So these ones that were general knowledge, you could find. This one that was getting into detailed knowledge, this was effectively a non-targetable topic. It had to be broken down into smaller quizzes, and each one of them could be targeted afterwards individually. So here's another experimental result. So what we have here is the percentage of correct answers submitted by the users as a function of the number of answers that they submit. If you look at the users that submitted just one answer, their quality was effectively random. So four answers, probability of answering correctly, you know, 25%, completely random. However, if you go to the users that submitted 100 answers, you see their quality gets higher and higher and higher, and these people get closer to 70% average accuracy. So what we have here is we have self-selection playing in our favor. People that participate in this quiz, they have absolutely no incentive to keep playing if they are not performing well. So people that don't do well, they naturally drop out and they don't pollute the results with low quality answers, which actually it's a very good result. And now do the comparison with paid crowdsourcing. So what we did is we went to Mechanical Turk and we hired people and we're saying, here's a quiz, you get paid for each answer that you provide. And we also hired people on Odesk and we're saying, okay, we hire you, we pay you whatever hourly rate you asked for, go to this quiz and please provide answers to the questions asked. We didn't do any quality control for that. We just hired them directly. And here's the result. So in quiz, we have random people coming. And if you look how much they participate, you see that their quality increases as they participate more. For Odesk and quiz, Mechanical Turk, effectively, their average quality remains random and is not affected by participation. Why? Because they get paid the more they participate. So, of course, we said, okay, since we do no quality control, this is not a fair comparison. although it indicates that money keeps people going. So we said, okay, let's do the following thought experiment. Magically, let's say that we find the best person in the pool magically. Somehow, before hiring, we know who is going to be the best worker from Odesk or Mechanical Turk, and find this person. So our best worker was somewhere here above the line, you know, so this greenish dot had 68% quality, answered 40 questions, took approximately 60 to 90 seconds per question. In comparison, if you look at the average time spent for each quiz user, it was about 10 seconds per question. Quiz users, either they know the answer, and they give the answer, or they drop out. This person was spending a lot of time researching and trying to find the answers. Of course, this generates an interesting effect. So if we want to have exactly the same performance, cost-benefit performance, we need to pay on average 5 cents per question on to get the same benefit that we had. This is equivalent, given the time that it takes to answer, to $3 per hour. That's a really low salary to pay. Why? Because the users that we hire from labor markets, they don't have their knowledge in their heads. Therefore, they are not efficient. So yes, they can provide reasonable quality, but they are not efficient, because when you target people, they can provide the answers very, very quickly. Actually, at some point, I even gave this very difficult quiz about artists and song to a friend of mine. She used to be a lead singer in a punk band in East Village, high school graduate, passionate with music. She started playing this artist song. That's cool. I suck. 80% accuracy. I say, wow, that's the best performing person that I had. Well, but she was passionate with music, so she was able to perform really well in the most difficult quiz that we had. And something that we cannot do in labor markets at this point. So here's another example. So first of all, I want to mention that there is a good carrot that Google gives $10,000 per month in advertising budget for free to nonprofits in order to run advertising on their platform. So, and we did one experiment, a few experiments. So we worked with MIT for a project called the Climate Collab. What they are trying to do is they are trying to recruit people to contribute proposals for climate change mitigation. We're talking about really big ideas crowdsourcing, right? Not micro knowledge crowdsourcing. We started running advertising campaigns. We doubled the traffic with just a $20 per budget. But the most interesting thing was we're saying calls for feedback, the user contributed a comment or a vote or a proposal and so on, and we're targeting like that. The most interesting result was not that we increased participation, but the AdWords system, 2 weeks after we started running the campaign, comes back and says, this climate change campaign that you have doesn't seem to perform very well. And we detected that this is because you don't target properly. You target all these climate change things, but here are a few other websites that you might want to consider targeting, and started presenting topics like feminist forums, civil liberties, you know, websites, you know, ACLU, and so on. We're looking at that, like, that's puzzling. But we realized what was going on. Effectively, if you target climate change, you find people that are interested in learning about climate change, not people that want to participate in such projects. However, if you target people that have a tradition in activism and civil liberties and so on, these are people that have the inclination to participate in such projects. Therefore, when we started targeting ACLU and so on, these were naturally inclined people to participate in social causes and contribute more and more things. We also do another experiment now where we're trying to target not knowledge but psychological traits. So for psychology, we want to have campaigns that say, okay, can we get conservatives to participate in this experiment? Or can we get liberals to participate in this experiment? That actually works really well. We also try to target now other things like, can I target introverts? Can I target extroverts? By doing the standard training, right? So we come, people participate in quizzes that measure introversion, extroversion, and we do that. Or the other experiment that we're running is, how can we get people that have high or low time discounting factor, which means how far ahead in the future they plan or how short term they are thinking. Apparently that one tends to work well. Brief hint, it seems that socioeconomic status affects your time discounting. So the richer you are, the more further ahead you are thinking. The poorer you are, the short-term thinking you have. And therefore, you can target things like that. So yeah, that's pretty much it. So the basic idea is that you can have an alternative way of running crowdsourcing campaigns, not by paying people, but by running advertising campaigns and being able to target for various topics. You avoid having the problems of payment, and you engage people that are really interested in your topics, and it's possible to find access to expertise that is not available in these platforms. And if you are running a non-profit or a citizen science application, it's also possible to piggyback on Google's grants and get $10,000 budget every month for free to run campaigns and attract users to your website to participate in such efforts. So that's pretty much it. And I'm happy to take many questions.